Deadly Reprisal. Detective Zoe Finch, Book 5. Written by Rachel McLean. Narrated by Jan Cramer. Chapter 1.
Not that one.
Kayla felt her chest tighten as her friend Lynn raised a hand to knock on the door. Lynn turned to her, eyes flashing into the camera lens.
Yeah, let's leave that one for now.
She smiled, injecting a note of breeziness into her voice and lifting her chin for the most flattering angle.
We'll start at the far end of the corridor and work our way along.
Kayla let out a short breath, glancing back at the door as they headed towards the other end of the corridor. It had just gone midnight, and they were stalking the corridors of Bolton Hall of Residence. Lynn was on the hunt, as usual, for material for her YouTube channel. Bass reverberated through the building from the party 3 floors below, and Kayla could hear distant laughter. Lynn cleared her throat, raised a fist to the last door in the corridor, and turned to the camera.
Hey, party people, welcome to Lynn's Lens. Tonight is the Valentine's Ball at Bolton Hall, and we're expecting plenty of dirt.
She leaned in, her eyes wide.
And you can expect us to dish it out for you.
Lynn knocked on the door, her gaze still on the camera. She winked, and Kayla suppressed an eye roll. Lynn was in her element recording for her channel. She spent far more time on this than she did on her studies.
Oh, shucks, Lynn exclaimed.
She liked to broaden her mild Texas accent for the videos. Her mum was from Hong Kong, and her dad from Austin. But the fact that she'd grown up in Hemel Hempstead wasn't something she shared with her audience.
No one home.
She turned to check the nameplate on the door.
Susie must be partying downstairs with the rest of them.
Which is where we should be, muttered Kayla.
Knocking on doors like this, spying on people, it made her uneasy, especially since they'd eventually have to knock on the door she'd persuaded Lynn away from.
Come on.
Lynn waved an arm in a follow-me gesture and hurried along the corridor, knocking on doors and pushing on each to check if any had been left unlocked. At the second, they were yelled at by 2 guys. Lynn sliced at her throat, gesturing for Kayla to hit pause. The 4th door was open, and she went inside without waiting for an invitation. Kayla's toes curled in her shoes.
Ha, no one home, Lynn shrugged. Nice wall art, though.
She swept a hand behind her, and Kayla followed with the camera, taking in the occupant's collection of soft porn.
Ooh,
she thought.
Ha,
Lynn said.
We can talk to Dan about his collection in another episode. Let's see if we can find anyone at home.
Kayla knew what Lynn was looking for. Couples she could interrupt. Threesomes even better. Capturing drug-taking on camera. She didn't upload everything she filmed. Sometimes it suited her to have her subjects know she was keeping the footage for a future date. As a result, Lynn never paid for her own drinks, and even textbooks materialized from nowhere. Kayla wasn't sure how she felt about being a conspirator in what could only be described as extortion. But one thing she was sure about was that she didn't want to be Lynn's next victim. 8 doors and 1 snogging couple. Dull, Lynn pronounced. Later, they arrived back at the 1st door.
Now to see what Bolton Hall's biggest creep is up to, Lynn said.
Kayla put a hand out to stop her, but it was too late. Lynn had knocked. Lawrence Toms, the room's occupant, would be in there. No one had seen him at the party. No one had seen him anywhere other than the mandatory tutorials for a month now. And they all knew why.
It's open!
Lynn's eyes gleamed as she pushed on the wood. Kayla swallowed the lump in her throat.
Let's see what he's up to, huh?
Kayla squeezed her eyes shut, not looking at the image on the camera screen. Lawrence's face was all too familiar to her. It haunted her nightmares. She heard Lynn's footsteps as her friend walked into the room and stumbled after her, the camera pointing ahead, but her eyes not following. Lynn made a low sound and stopped. Kayla crashed into her friend and opened her eyes. The room was dark.
Where are you, creep? Lynn whispered. Hope you haven't dragged some poor girl up here and drugged her into submission.
Kayla winced. She knew the possible consequences if Lynn accused Lawrence of a crime on video, but then... Shit! Lynn's voice was breathy. What? I felt something. Open the fucking door. What? It's shut behind us. There's something on my foot. Lawrence, is that you? Kayla felt Lynn's hand on her arm. Open the door, Kay. I don't like this. Part of Kayla registered that this would make a great video. She wondered if Lynn's fear was genuine. Didn't you hear me? Open the fucking door! Lynn's voice was sharp. Kayla stumbled backwards, her body slamming into the door. She yanked on the handle, but her own weight was keeping it shut. Hurry! Came Lynn's voice. Kayla heard a groan. Lynn or someone else? Kayla shifted to one side and hauled the door open, then turned back to look at her friend. Lynn had crashed onto the unmade bed. Her face was pale and her breathing ragged. At her feet, curled up like a sleeping child, was Lawrence. Kayla recoiled at the sight of his thin frame and sharp cheekbones. Is he? She breathed. Lynn blinked. The young man at her feet wasn't moving. Lynn prodded him with her toe, rolling him to face upwards. His eyes were open. Lynn retched. Kayla stepped towards her. Come on, let's get out of here. He's taken something. Lynn looked up at her. She shook her head, her skin now almost as pale as Lawrence's. He's stone cold. Kayla forced herself to look back at the man. His jaw had fallen open and drool ran down his chin. She shuddered. He's dead, Kay. He's fucking dead.
Chapter 2. The safe house Anna Maria Albescu was being held in wasn't much better than the building she'd been forced to live in while being sold for sex. D.I. Zoe Finch sat on the oily sofa, arranging her feet on the threadbare carpet and telling herself not to move. Opposite her, D.S. Mo Adin perched on a high-backed chair that looked like it might collapse under his weight. It's a disgrace, Mo said, breaking the silence. What is? He raised his arms in a gesture to indicate the room. You know what these women went through. They should be in a sanctuary now, not this. He wiped a finger along the top of a chest of drawers and screwed up his nose. At least they're safe, Zoe pointed out. Mo grunted. The women living in this house in Bearwood had been the victims of an organised people trafficking and prostitution operation. They'd been persuaded to come to the UK from less wealthy countries in search of new lives, then forced to earn money for the men who'd paid for their passage. One of these women, Andrea Pitchler, had died in Zoe's arms. Another, whose name they still didn't know, had died when she'd set off a nail bomb in New Street Station. And Anna Maria, the woman they were here to see, was the only link they had to the bomber. After 2 weeks of silence, Zoe was hoping she might give them information that would help them discover who the bomber was and why she'd sacrificed herself. The door opened with a squeak. A chubby woman with curly blonde hair walked in with an apologetic look on her face. Tina Galton, the administrator. I'm sorry. She twisted her mouth in frustration, or perhaps apology. She won't leave her room. Not again, Mo breathed. Zoe slumped in her chair, wishing she hadn't bothered sitting down. It was the fourth time this had happened. She's scared, Tina said. She thinks that if she tells the police anything, the men will hurt her, or her son in Romania. Zoe nodded. The woman was probably right. Trevor Ham's organised crime operation had tentacles that reached into more places than they'd previously thought. If he could traffic women from Romania, he could most likely hurt people there too. It's all anonymous, she said. Anna Maria will never be named in court. Any records we keep, notes we take, we'll use a false name. She held out her notepad, indicating the Daniela she'd written at the top. See? I've told her that, Tina shrugged. Yeah, of course you have. Why would she believe us? Mo said. He stood up and wiped the dust off his fingers. No one in this country has proven exactly trustworthy. She'll be going home tomorrow, Tina said. We know, Zoe told her. All the more reason to persuade her to talk now. Sorry, I know it's important, but my responsibility is to the women. Zoe stood up. Important doesn't really cover it. Tina met her gaze. I know you've got a terror investigation to pursue, Inspector, but that's not my priority. Zoe eyed Mo. Come on then, let's get back to the office.
She followed Mo from the room, peering up the stairs as they passed them, and wondering if Anna Maria was listening in. Once the woman was back in Romania, she'd vanish, and their only lead to the bomber would be gone. Outside, she yanked open the door to her Mini, her mind racing.
We'll need to track down Ham's lot directly. You know what he's like, boss. We'll never pin anything on him.
Maybe if Ian talks.
Mo let out a sigh.
D.S. Osman's not going to tell us anything.
D.S. Ian Osman had been Zoe's sergeant until he'd got himself caught planting evidence at the scene of a second terror attack. Now they were hoping he'd lead them to the gang that had played a part in both attacks and done so much damage to so many people, the women in this house included. But so far, he was keeping his thoughts to himself.
She shook herself out. Come on, I've got a shed load of paperwork to get through, and the DCI wants me to revisit the files from those robberies in Chelmsley Wood.
Fun.
Yeah.
Zoe landed in the driver's seat heavily and turned the ignition. Her phone rang as she was about to put the car in gear.
Connie. Boss, where are you?
Hall Green, the safe house. Why?
The DCI wants you at a murder scene.
Zoe raised her eyebrows at Mo and switched to speakerphone.
Where? Birmingham University. Kid called Lawrence Toms. They thought he'd OD'd, but now they think it's suspicious.
Give me details.
Zoe started driving as Mo took down the address. Bolton Hall. Zoe glanced at Mo as she turned right off the Hagley Road.
Let's hope this one's a bit more straightforward.
Chapter 3. Bolton Hall was an angular modern building surrounded by bare trees and flanked by two small car parks. Zoe drove around each of them in turn, cursing the lack of parking spaces.
I'll drop you at the front, she told Mo. One of us might as well go in.
She pulled up to the front of the building and let Mo out. Reversing, she thought better of driving away and instead parked her car halfway up the pavement outside the entrance. She was investigating a murder. They'd hardly begrudge her some inconsiderate parking. Inside, Mo was talking to a large man in a black uniform.
We're from West Midlands Police investigating a suspicious death. I don't care, mate. You leave your car out there and it's an obstruction. What if a fire engine needs to get past?
We're police, Zoe told him. Emergency services too.
I don't see no blue lights.
She narrowed her eyes at him.
Tell me where to leave my car then, and it had better be nearby.
The security guard squared his shoulders, pleased with himself. He had a name badge sewn onto his sweater. Mark Jenks. Jobsworth, she thought.
Well?
She asked, resisting an urge to grab the man by the lapels.
There's a staff spot round the back.
He made a circling motion.
You can put it there.
I'll do it, said Mo. He held out a hand and Zoe passed him her keys. Thanks, she said. The last time a detective sergeant had driven her Mini, it had been Ian Osman, and he'd been trying to cover up his crimes. Mo was different, thank God.
Right, she said to Jenks. Show me the way.
He grunted and led her to a bank of lifts. As they rode upwards, she realised what had been bothering her since she'd entered the building.
Where is everyone? She asked.
It was 10:30 on a Monday morning. Even students would be awake by now. She thought of her son Nicholas, about to go off to uni himself, and not known for early rising.
We've confined them to their corridors, Jenks replied.
Can you do that?
In cases of emergency, yes. A kid's been killed. What if the killer's still in the building?
Heaven save me from overzealous security guards, she thought. Whose idea was that? He smiled.
Mine. The warden was in agreement.
Oh, he was he?
She. Yes, she was. They're all tucked up safe in their corridors.
What if they need to go to lectures?
He shrugged.
There's been a murder. That's more important.
Zoe sighed as the lift doors opened. The door closest to them hung open, voices spilling out beyond it, forensic floor protection plates leading inside. Zoe pulled on her overshoes and gloves and cleared her throat. Jenks hung behind her.
Thanks,
she told him. He nodded. I mean, you can go now, she said. He wrinkled his nose and stepped back into the lift.
Someone would have to interview the man later, find out what he knew. She hoped it wouldn't be her.
Hello,
she called. A white-suited tech with their back to her stood up and turned. The eyes, the only part of the human inside visible, crinkled at the sight of her.
Zoe!
AD, she replied, what have you got for me?
Good to see you too,
said AD Hansen, forensic scene manager. After a pause, he turned back to the room. A young man lay slumped against the bed, his face raised towards the ceiling and his mouth hanging open. White foam surrounded his lips and his skin was turning blue. On the carpet next to him was a splash of vomit.
Looks like an overdose to me, she said.
You'd think so, wouldn't you? Said AD. But look at his wrists, he pointed.
Zoe leaned forwards. The victim's wrists were ringed with purple-yellow bruises.
You think that's connected?
Not my job to put two and two together, Zoe. But there's marks in his nostrils too, scarring, and on his tongue and gums. Recent, I reckon.
You think someone forced drugs into him?
At first glance, it looks like an overdose, AD said. But apparently the girl who found him was a medical student, and she decided to take a look.
Great,
Zoe said. Tell me about it. But she may have done him a favour. The knuckle-dragger calling himself a security guard would never have called us out if she hadn't.
That's a bit rude, Zoe told him. AD turned to her, eyebrows raised. She suppressed a snort.
OK, so what did this medical student tell you? She's along the hall, he said. You can ask her yourself. Name's Lynn Johnson.
I'll get to her in a minute. First, tell me about the scene. Any signs of a struggle? Someone forcing their way in?
No forced entry. But if these students are anything like I was back in the day, no one locks their door anyway.
AD pointed to a folded-up sheet of cardboard next to the door, which was now propped open with a chair.
Wedge them open like.
OK, so someone came in, but he didn't want them here, and he certainly didn't want them shoving drugs into him.
Hi. Mo hurried in, bringing a cloud of cold air with him. Your car's bloody miles away. Sorry. Zoe took her keys from him and shoved them into the pocket of her jeans. That's OK, AD's telling me about signs of a struggle.
Well, it's not all that cut and dried, AD said. I mean, the kid could have just been a slob. And if he had been using, then he might have done himself some damage. But there's books all over the floor, and that mug.
He pointed to a mug which lay on its side beneath the bed, liquid puddling beneath it.
What about the body? Mo asked. Defensive wounds?
We've got bruising on the wrists, said AD.
Could have been self-inflicted, Mo said, if he was an addict.
They're fresh, AD said, but the pathologist will be able to confirm.
Where is Adana anyway? Zoe asked.
She's sending one of her team, AD said. This is small beer for her, especially as I couldn't convince her it definitely wasn't an overdose.
Maybe she's right, said Zoe.
The only way to be sure is for a pathologist to take a look, said AD.
Do I detect professional tension?
Zoe asked. Ignore me, AD said. I just want them to take him away so we've got a bit more room in here.
He did have a point. The room couldn't have been more than 2.5 metres square, and it housed a bed, a desk, a wardrobe, 2 detectives and 3 FSIs, as well as a body.
OK, Zoe said. I'll get out of your way.
Mo, let's go talk to this Lynn girl.
Chapter 4. Kayla clamped her hands over her knees, trying to stop the trembling. She'd fled to her room after they'd found Lawrence. Lynn had tried, and failed, to calm her down. His room had stunk, vomit and shit and something else she couldn't identify. She'd been in there before, of course. It hadn't smelled good before, but it had been nothing like this. An image of his pale face on the floor flashed through her head and she let out a whimper. She jerked her face up to check the door. They'd confined the students to their corridors, which meant she was alone. The other students on her corridor were wary of her. They knew she was somehow damaged, but they didn't want to find out more.
But she couldn't risk anyone coming in.
Kayla pulled herself up, pushing past the weakness in her legs, and stumbled to the door. She leaned against it as she turned the lock. Someone was outside, talking.
He had it coming, said a voice.
Kayla leaned against the door, trying to still her breathing.
You can't say that, said another. No one deserves that.
Maybe he did. He was bad news.
A third voice, lower. This one was male, the other two female.
They're saying he took an overdose.
You reckon he killed himself?
Maybe. What with it all hanging over him?
Silence. Kayla pictured the three people outside. Dawn, Siobhan and Ricky. They'd be staring into space, trying to make out like they were affected by it all, trying to pretend they cared. Well, she cared. She'd been there when he'd been found, and she'd known what he was like. For weeks. She should have told someone.
She brushed tears from her cheeks and staggered back to the bed. There was movement outside. Her doorknob turned.
Kayla, you in there?
She stared at the door. She shook her head.
Kayla?
Leave her. She doesn't want to talk to us.
Yeah, we might give her the plague or something.
Laughter. Kayla tensed, wishing she had the courage to go out there and talk to them. To tell them what she knew.
She couldn't. She would take it to the grave.
She let herself fall back onto the bed and curled into a ball. She grasped her legs, hugging herself, and allowed the sobs to rip through her body.
Chapter 5.
Lynn Johnson.
Zoe stepped into the room, a smile on her face. The student sat on the bed with a female constable beside her, PC Lark.
That's me.
The young woman straightened and met Zoe's gaze. How are you doing?
I'm good.
A slight American accent.
You from the US?
Lynn stared at her for a moment, then shook her head.
My dad is, but I'm from Hemel.
Hemel?
Hempstead, outside London.
I know where it is. Lynn nodded and wiped her face with her sleeve. Despite the bravado, her cheeks were blotched with tears. Zoe nodded at the PC, who gave the girl a reassuring rub on the shoulder and stood to leave the room.
I'll get you a cuppa, she said.
Zoe exchanged glances with Mo, who was still standing in the doorway. Cups of tea, the family liaison officer's answer to everything. She doubted the students drank much tea.
Why not make that something stronger? Zoe suggested.
Lynn looked up at her, a smile flickering across her lips.
Vodka?
There's a bottle in the wardrobe,
Lynn replied. PC Lark frowned.
It's only 11 o'clock.
I think Lynn's been through enough of an ordeal to justify a drink, Zoe said.
Have you slept?
Lynn shook her head. The PC grunted and opened the wardrobe door. After the vodka had been found and the student had downed two generous shots, Zoe sat in the chair opposite the bed. Mo was still hovering at the door. PC Lark had left.
My name's Detective Inspector Zoe Finch. This is Detective Sergeant Mo Uddin. You don't need me to tell you why we're here.
Lynn shook her head.
There were contusions on his prochilon, lacerations to the frenulum. I can write it all down or make a video for you.
Zoe put her hand up.
It's okay, Lynn. To be honest, I don't understand half of what you just said anyway, and the pathologist will be able to figure all that out. So why? You found him. We need you to describe what happened.
Lynn slumped into herself. She was short and slender with cropped dark hair. Zoe thought of Andrea Pitchler, the Romanian woman who died in her arms. Superficially, the two young women were nothing like each other, but there was something in this girl that reminded Zoe of Andrea.
He was lying on the floor next to his bed, Lynn said.
Wait a minute, said Mo. We'll need you to start at the beginning.
Lynn frowned. From when I opened the door?
Before that. Why did you go to his room? Did you see him beforehand?
No one had seen him for days.
Days? Asked Mo.
Yeah, he was kind of reclusive, you might say. Attended tutorials, the ones he had to, but that was it. The uni had started putting lectures online, helps overseas students, they say, but really it encourages introverts to stay in their rooms and everyone else to get up late.
So when did you last see him, Lynn? Zoe asked. A shrug.
About a month ago, I guess.
Her face darkened. So why did you go to his room? Mo asked.
We were making a video. Lynn's Lens. I'm a creator. That's my channel. I was looking for dirt. You usually get a lot of it when there's a party on. People making out, taking drugs, that kind of shit.
She clapped her hand to her mouth. Sorry.
Mo scratched his head. So he gave the young woman a smile. We're police. We're used to swearing, you know.
First hand in her case, Mo added.
The student blushed and nodded.
Sorry.
Zoe leaned towards her.
So you went to his room thinking you might be able to catch him on camera taking drugs?
I don't know why I went to his room. Not really. Guy's a creep. Kayla didn't want me to go. I think she's allergic to him. Don't blame her.
So is Kayla the other person making the video? Mo asked.
Yeah, she was behind the camera, always is.
Anyone else there? Zoe asked.
Place was deserted. They were all downstairs at their pathetic party.
You're not a fan of university parties? Zoe asked. The girl shrugged.
They're okay, I guess. Plenty of material for the channel, but
yeah, not a fan. Okay, said Mo. So you came to his room with your camera and... Zoe raised a finger. Wait, where's the footage?
Oh, yeah, Kayla's got it, Lim replied.
Zoe turned to Mo. We're going to need to speak to her ASAP. In fact, can you go to her now, get that tape?
It isn't a tape, Lin said. No one uses tape anymore.
File, Zoe said. You know what I mean. Where is Kayla?
A shrug. In her room, I guess.
Zoe sighed. Any chance you might give me her room number? Lin eyed her and recited a number. Zoe gestured at Mo, who left the room.
Right, Zoe said to Lin. So you went to his room and you found him on the floor. Did you see anyone else around?
No one. We passed his door about 10 minutes earlier, too.
Okay. Where did you go in those 10 minutes?
Along the corridor. We were filming, seeing what we could get.
Were you in sight of Lawrence's door the whole time?
Sort of. Kayla would have been, but she was looking at the screen, filming.
She didn't say she'd seen anything, no one coming or going.
You'd have to ask her.
We will. Let's go back to when you found him. What did you do?
Lynn swallowed.
I took a look at him.
Zoe nodded, slowly. It wasn't this student's job to do her own post-mortem, but there was no point in berating her for it now. Describe that.
I'd already rolled him over with my foot.
Lynn looked into Zoe's eyes.
I was careful not to touch him. I had gloves in my pocket.
You always carry surgical gloves.
We'd been doing anatomy that afternoon. I'd put them in my pocket instead of handing them over for disposal.
Great, Zoe thought. Now they had a body contaminated by whatever Lynn had brought in on those gloves.
She clenched a fist and nodded for Lynn to continue.
He had foam coming from his mouth and he'd vomited. So I took a look at his lips and his gums. He had bruising and lacerations, small cuts. The frenulum.
She opened her mouth and put her finger on the webbing between her gum and upper lip.
And on the lower gums and the prochylon, here.
She shifted her finger to her own upper lip.
You talk to my colleague about this, the crime scene manager, Zoe said. The cute guy in the mask? Yeah, I think he was impressed.
Zoe tightened her fist.
She wondered if Adana's colleague had arrived yet. They needed a professional autopsy, not the ham-fisted efforts of a medical student.
What year are you in? She asked.
Lynn blushed.
First year.
Of course, Zoe thought. Keen, but inexperienced. Maybe Adana not being here was a blessing. She could only imagine the pathologist's reaction to Lynn.
Okay, Zoe said. So what did you do after that?
I went looking for Kayla.
Kayla had gone.
I hadn't noticed. I was too busy looking at Lawrence. I found her in the bathroom at the end of the hall, shitting herself she was.
Well, not literally, but you know what I mean.
Then what? Jensen appeared. He's our pastoral tutor, supposed to look after us.
I guess he'd heard Kayla. She was shrieking by that point, and I told him.
Did anyone else go into Lawrence's room?
No, Jensen shut the door. He sent everyone away, and he told security. I didn't see anything else.
Chapter 6.
Zoe leaned against a wall outside the hall of residence and took out her phone. The area was quiet, no students coming or going. She wondered how long it would be before they rebelled.
Hey, boss.
DC Rodri Hughes's voice was perky.
Rodri, you got Connie with you?
Both here, boss, awaiting your command.
Put me on speakerphone.
Zoe wondered if she should wait for Mo, but she had no idea which part of the building Kayla's room was in.
Boss.
Connie's voice came on the line.
Okay, you two. Zoe said. We've got a 19-year-old male killed by what might be an overdose but could be suspicious. Signs that someone may have forced whatever killed him into his mouth. I'm waiting for the pathologist to get here.
And where is Adana's colleague? She wondered.
But in the meantime, I want you to check out our victim. Lawrence Toms comes from Leeds, studying chemistry in his first year. A bit of a recluse from what I've been told.
Find out if he's got a record, if he's reported any threats or attacks, anything you can dredge up.
No problem, said Rodri. You want us to liaise with university security?
Zoe could imagine that Mark Jenks guy responding better to the constables than to her or Mo. Yes, the guard on duty is Mark Jenks. Rodri, you get him out here and talk to him. Find out what you can from him and his colleagues about the students involved, whether there's anything suspicious we need to know about.
There's more than one of them? Connie asked.
He was found by a Lynn Johnson and a Kayla Good. I've spoken to Lynn. Mo's talking to Kayla right now. There's something that made me wonder about Lynn. I want to know about their relationship with Lawrence, if they had one, and any other students. There'll be staff at Bolton Hall who might be more willing to tell us what's going on than the students.
Boss, Rodri said.
I'll call you back when the pathologist has turned up, Zoe said. Let you know if there's anything you can follow up on. She heard Rodri make a guttural noise.
You want to go to the post-mortem, Rod?
Zoe laughed. Don't worry, Constable. It's Connie's turn.
Really?
Connie sounded hesitant. We all have to do it at some point. Believe me, Connie, this one won't be as bad as some you'll see.
OK.
Zoe heard the two constables mutter between themselves.
What is it?
She asked.
Nothing, boss. I'll let you know when I'm at the uni,
Rodri replied. Good. Keep me informed.
Chapter 7. Kayla jumped at a knock on her door. She shrank back onto the bed, her knees drawn up.
Who is it?
My name's Detective Sergeant Mo Uddin. I need to ask you some questions. She felt ice run down her back. The others would be out there watching him, wondering what was going on. They'd have let him in the outer door.
Okay,
she whispered and crossed to the door. She turned the lock and peered out. The corridor was empty, except for a middle-aged Asian man with a friendly smile. He held up a police badge. Hi, Kayla. Sorry to bother you, but can I come in? Kayla's gaze darted along the corridor. Ricky's door was open a crack, listening in. She felt like screaming.
Come in.
The detective followed her into the room and looked around for something to prop the door open with. Of course, she thought, he wouldn't want to risk being alone with her in case she accused him of something.
Here,
she said. She reached under the bed and brought out the stuffed dog she used to hold the door when she was feeling sociable.
Thanks.
He placed it next to the door and turned to give her a wary smile. She looked past him into the corridor. They'd all be listening in. But at least if they knew the truth, they wouldn't be able to speculate. She would just have to be careful what she said.
Mind if I sit?
The detective put a hand on the back of her work chair. She nodded and he pulled it out and slipped into it. She took her place on her bed, legs drawn up to her chest.
We've been talking to Lynn, the man said. She says the two of you were making a video.
Kayla nodded.
Could you let me have a copy?
Oh, yes, of course.
The camera was behind him on the desk. She'd used her phone at first, but Lynn had complained that they needed something with higher resolution. The camera had turned up one morning as they were about to film. Kayla didn't know if Lynn had got her folks to pay for it, or if she'd acquired it some other way, maybe even stolen it.
It's right there, she pointed.
The detective picked up the camera and turned it over in his hand.
Here, she said, there's an SD card.
She held out her hand and he passed it to her. She flicked the button to open the card slot and tipped it into her hand, then passed it to him.
Thanks, he said. Mind if I take the camera too?
Kayla frowned. What would Lynn say?
Okay.
She handed it back to him. He brought a plastic bag out of his pocket and put both camera and card inside. He placed the bag on the desk and turned to look at her. She blinked under his gaze.
So, he said, how are you?
Fine,
she grunted.
Just get on with it, she thought.
Your roommates, is that the right term, were worried about you.
He gestured towards the door.
Yeah, right, she thought.
Oh,
she said.
They said you came running in here at around 12:30 and locked yourself in your room. You haven't been out since.
Kayla shrugged.
What you saw, it can't have been easy.
She pursed her lips but said nothing. Her skin felt hot.
I'm going to need to ask you what happened.
It's on the video,
she whispered. He glanced at the camera.
We'll look at that, he said, and I'm grateful for it, but I'll need your account too. She shifted on the bed. Her hands felt cold. Would you like me to fetch someone for support? She shook her head. He'd get Jensen, the residential tutor. She didn't want that. No, she said. Can you call your parents? Would they come and take care of you? I'm sure some leave. No, she clenched her fists. No. She hadn't spoken to her parents since Christmas, and even then she'd returned to Birmingham as soon as she could. Her mum had a way of looking into her face and reading her thoughts, and Kayla didn't want that. I'm fine, she said. Ask your questions. She straightened, shifting her back up the wall and putting her legs out in front of her. She wished she had another chair. Okay, he smiled. There was a party on, yes?
The Valentine's ball.
And you and Lynn decided to come upstairs and make a video?
Lynn likes to record when there's a party on. Capture the stuff that happens in the shadows, she says.
Had you seen Lawrence before you went to his room?
No.
When was the last time you saw him?
She bit her lip. I don't know. A while.
Truth was, she avoided him, especially now, after what had happened with that Becca girl. Okay, whose idea was it to go to his room?
Lynn's. I tried to stop her. We went along the rest of his corridor first, but then she said it was his turn.
She tugged at her sleeve.
I wasn't keen.
Why not?
He never comes out. I didn't like the idea of disturbing him.
She gazed at her fingers, turning them over in her lap. Was his door locked? Kayla shook her head.
We wouldn't have gone in if it had been.
Was it normally locked? She felt heat pass through her.
How would I know?
He frowned at her and shrugged. Just a question. She swallowed.
I don't know. Most people don't lock their doors, but he might have.
Why is that?
Her back stiffened. Like I said, he's a recluse, doesn't like people.
The detective stared at her for a moment, deepening her discomfort. Okay, he said at last. So when you found him, what did you see?
Why are you asking me this? She thought. Surely they could see for themselves. He was on the floor. It was dark. Lynn hit him with her foot. We opened the door to let some light in, and he was there.
She shivered, remembering his body slumped next to the bed. It was Lynn who opened the door.
It might have been me. Sorry, I can't.
He smiled. Don't worry. Our memories can play tricks with us when things like this happen. Yeah, she thought, they can. She stared back at him, trying to keep her face impassive. Did either of you touch him? The man asked.
Lynn pushed him with her foot. He rolled over.
She felt sick. Then I left. You came back here? Her eyes ached, tears fizzing behind them.
Sorry, I shouldn't have left her there.
It's understandable. He reached into his jacket pocket and pulled out a card. If you think of anything else, will you call me? She nodded. And I'll make sure you get your camera back as soon as we're done with it, he said.
Thanks,
she murmured. He smiled as he stood up. He held out his hand, but withdrew it when she didn't respond. Thanks, Kayla. You take care of yourself, yes? She shrugged as he left the room, then fell back against the wall, tears pouring down her cheeks.
Chapter 8.
So, what we got? Zoe asked. She was in her car, Mo in the passenger seat and Rodri in the back. They were parked in the spot Mo had been directed to, a good 10 minutes' walk from Bolton Hall. At least it afforded them some privacy.
The security guard's a busted flush, boss, Rodri said. Didn't even go into the room. I think he was worried he'd get a grilling if he disturbed anything.
Did he give you any information about the students, whether Lynn or Kayla had any dealings with Lawrence, who his friends were?
He told me the two girls are nosy parkers. His words, always creeping around the building filming people.
Zoe wondered what they'd done to piss Jenks off. What about Lawrence?
Kept himself to himself, like your witness said. Hardly came out of his room. I spoke to the bursar, and he said the kid hadn't taken any of the meals on his meal plan for 2 weeks.
Do they have cooking facilities in the rooms?
Each corridor has a communal kitchen and living room, said Mo, but according to the students on that floor, he never used that.
So where did he eat?
Judging by the state of his room, he was living on a diet of Jacob's crackers and pom bears, Mo said.
Nice.
If it hadn't been for Zoe's son and his culinary skills, that wouldn't have been too far off her own diet.
So was he pals with any of those kids on his corridor then? Rodri asked Mo. Nope, none of them had any dealings with him.
Poor lad.
He's 19. Was, said Zoe, hardly a wee laddie.
Rodri shrugged. Suppose so.
So, she sighed, we haven't got much to go on until the pathologist reports. Where the hell is he or she anyway? Her phone rang.
AD. Good news, Zoe.
Tell me it's Adana.
Not Adana, sorry. Next best thing, her colleague Brent.
Brent?
Dr. Brent Reynolds.
Never heard of him.
He's new.
He's also bloody late.
Had to come from Leicester, apparently.
Why did Adana send us someone who was in Leicester?
Are you coming back here or what?
AD asked.
He'll be gone in 5 minutes.
On my way. Zoe hung up and told Mo to head back to the office in Rodri's car. I'll be right behind you, she said. Not much to do here. Find out if Connie's made any progress. Mo nodded, and he and Rodri got out of the car. She followed and headed back to Bolton Hall. Inside, she gave Mark Jenks a cursory nod as she passed his office, then called the lift, sighing. She wasn't looking forward to meeting this Dr. Reynolds. When she arrived at Lawrence's room, the pathologist was on the floor next to the body, examining the inside of the young man's cheeks.
Dr. Reynolds, Zoe said, nice of you to join us.
He turned to look up at her, his eyes narrow.
Don't bloody blame me, fucking pile up on the M1.
She twisted her lips in irritation. You could have called ahead, maybe got a colleague to fill in for you.
We're short-staffed. I'm only here because I've been seconded to fill a gap while they do recruitment. So, what can you tell me?
Rig is only just setting in and the room's chilly, so I'd say somewhere between 8 and 12 hours. I can be more accurate when I do the PM. Judging by the marks inside his mouth, something was inserted into it by force.
A weapon?
He shook his head, his back to her.
Fingers, I reckon. We'll take swabs, test for DNA, look more closely for fingernail marks. Of course, it might just turn out to be him forcing his own fingers down his throat, but the bruising doesn't quite fit with that.
So you think someone forced drugs down his throat?
There's remains of foaming. Could be drugs, could be something else. But let's not jump to conclusions, eh, Inspector?
I'll run a toxicology analysis when he's safely with us, and then I can tell you. But you might still be looking at a suicide. Zoe folded her arms across her chest. The kid was a recluse with no friends, and the way the young women talked about him made her suspect he was an outcast. Suicide would fit.
Fine, she said. Let me know when you've got the results.
She gave Adie a nod and turned to leave. She still needed to follow up on the investigation into the New Street bomber, now known as the Magpie case. Then there was the professional standards investigation to worry about, not to mention Ian's looming trial. If she'd been dragged into this and it turned out to be a wild goose chase.
You leaving us?
Adie asked. I'll be in the office if you need me, she said. Failing that, I'll be somewhere along the 10-mile hike back to my car.
Chapter 9. Kayla knew they were out there, talking about her. They always were. She lay on the bed, her face buried in the pillow, wishing she'd never agreed to do that stupid video. The party had been okay. She'd been chatting to a girl from her course. She'd been happy staying where she was. But Lynn had a way of making you do what she wanted. Kayla pushed herself up, dragging her dark hair back from her face and went to the door. She had to escape sometime, and she knew where she'd rather be. She pushed the door open a crack and peered out. The hallway was quiet, the only sound music coming from Siobhan's room. Kayla slipped through the door and crept to the outer door, careful to close it silently behind her. She hurried to the back stairs, avoiding the main flight down to the front entrance and security office. She raced down, her breathing shallow. At the bottom was a fire door that wasn't connected to an alarm. Outside, a group of students stood smoking under a tree. She recognised Ricky from her corridor.
Kayla.
She winced and turned to face him.
Hi, Ricky.
You okay?
Fine. I thought everyone was still shut in.
Ha, they decided they couldn't imprison us any longer.
We'd have broken out if they hadn't let us go,
said a blonde girl next to him. She shivered. None of them were wearing coats, despite the February cold. Kayla realised she hadn't stopped to get a coat herself. It didn't matter. She didn't have far to go.
See you later, she said.
The students nodded and turned back to their huddle. Kayla ran across the damp grass. When she reached Edgbaston Park Road, she felt herself breathe freely again, as if the campus had been suffocating her. She hurried towards Sellyoak, ignoring the blast of exhaust fumes from a bus as she rounded the corner to the Bristol Road. 5 minutes later, she was hammering on the front door of a terraced house, her limbs trembling with the cold. The door opened, and a skinny guy with an undercut and blotchy skin stared at her.
"What you doing here?"
"Is he in?"
"Dunno. See for yourself."
The man stood to one side, and Kayla swept past him and up the stairs. She knocked on a bedroom door, then pushed it open without waiting for a reply.
"Kayla."
The man inside stood up from his seat on the floor, knocking over an ashtray and shoving something inside his shirt.
"It's only me, Jensen, you're fine."
He winked at her and brought out the object.
"Give me some," she said, holding out her hand. "I need it."
"It's not the usual," he said. "I don't think..."
"Just let me..."
She yanked it from his hand and brought it to her lips. She inhaled deeply and choked as the sharp smoke filled her lungs.
"Shit, Jensen, what the..."
"I did warn you."
He took the pipe from her hand and guided her into an armchair. Its stuffing was spilling out, but she was glad of the support.
"What was it?"
she croaked, her head spinning.
"Meth."
"Shit,"
he laughed. "Yeah." He held the pipe towards her. It was made of glass, not ceramic.
"Wrong kind of pipe, sweetie. You thought it was hash, didn't you?"
She nodded, placing her hands on the arms for balance. She leaned back. The drug had taken her by surprise, but it felt good to lose herself, to let some of the tension go.
"Thanks,"
she moaned. He smiled and bent over her, placing a soft kiss on her lips. She battered him away.
"No!"
"It's okay."
He dropped to the floor and stroked her face. She shuddered, feeling as if some strange creature was pawing at her.
"It's only me," he whispered. "It's fun. Makes it more intense.
I'm not in the..."
"Shh."
He kissed her again, deeply this time. She let his tongue explore her mouth and wrapped her own around it. He was right. It did feel good. She giggled.
"See," he said.
"See,"
she replied. She reached up and linked her hands around the back of his neck.
"See."
She felt him smile into her mouth. He smelled of heated metal. It was reassuring, familiar.
"I wanted to talk,"
she began.
"Hush."
He pulled her up and helped her to the bed. She stumbled as her foot hit its side, then slumped onto it.
"Kayla, did anyone ever tell you you're beautiful?"
"You did,"
she whispered into his cheek.
"Yesterday."
"So I did."
He fingered her shirt and pulled it up over her breasts. She felt her bra loosen.
"Lawrence, he..."
"Shh."
She stroked his face. His skin was smooth. He'd shaved.
"You're soft,"
she said.
"So are you."
He unbuttoned her shirt and let it fall to the floor. He leaned back and peeled off his own T-shirt. She smiled up at him, her limbs soft.
"Skid,"
she said.
"I told you." He put a finger to her lips. "Don't do it again, though. Dangerous."
She felt a jolt run through her. She pushed him off and turned, leaning against the wall.
"He died!"
Jensen cocked his head.
"Who?"
He stared into her eyes, his pupils dilated. She wondered how much of the meth he'd smoked. She blinked. Her mind was clearing. The memory of Lawrence lying on the floor, jerking her back to reality.
"Lawrence Toms! We found him! He..."
She sprang off the bed. She needed to puke. She crashed towards the bathroom, just catching Jensen's sigh of irritation as she flew out of the door.
Chapter 10. DC Connie Williams couldn't decide if she hated being left on her own in the office or secretly loved it. She stared into her computer screen, numbers and information washing through her mind, and allowed herself to relax. She knew this was the way the boss felt when she sifted through documentary evidence. For Connie, it was computer files and databases running through the digital world. She was able to achieve a zen-like calm that let her make connections and spot things others might not. Her little brother Zaf had laughed at her when she'd told him about this. She'd made damn sure not to share it with anyone else since, not even the DI, who she expected would be sympathetic. Rodri had gone off to the university.
He liked chatting to people. It was his happy place, his moment of zen. If Rodri could ever be accused of anything approaching zen. Mo was with the boss, a state of affairs that made Connie want to hug herself with relief. She'd hated DSE and Osman. From the moment he'd walked into the team room, the two of them had rubbed each other up the wrong way. He'd ordered her to go home in the middle of the investigation into Zaf's abduction, and he treated her like an inferior member of the team, someone of less value because she was happier dealing with data and not witnesses. It wasn't like she couldn't deal with witnesses too. Amelia Dowd, the nice old lady who lived next door to one of the victims in the Digbeth Ripper case, she'd loved Connie. Okay, so she'd loved Rodri even more, but still. But the best thing about being shot of Ian was...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.